Hi, you're watching New York State Legislative Report with Senator Jack Martins. I'm Julia Locheny. Today, the Senator and I are going to talk about what's going on in the New York State Senate and on Long Island. It's great to be with you again, Senator.
Great to be here, Julia. Thank you.
Thank you for being here. The Senate passed the governor's property tax bill back in January, but the Assembly has yet to act on it, and there's only about a month left in the legislative session. You and the Long Island delegation got together, and you're really trying to pressure the Assembly to act on it. Let's go straight out to a video of you talking about this.
Thank you.
Our current course is unsustainable. We're looking at people being literally taxed out of their homes. One of the first things I learned when I got to Albany, somebody taught me about Albany math, where 1 + 1 can equal 3. And if you think about it, the governor's committed, he gets it. The Senate certainly is committed. We passed it overwhelmingly with bipartisan support. It's time that the Assembly got it, and with your help, we'll get there.
So remind us what this bill would do.
Well, it caps property taxes at 2%. I think if there's anything that resonates right now and anything that's necessary right now, it's property tax relief. Across New York State, people are struggling to get through some rather difficult times, and there's been one constant. Every year, property taxes have gone up significantly. The home where we held that press conference, they bought their house 8 years ago, and here we are in 2011, their property taxes have gone from $6,000 to over $11,000. Where else have we seen that kind of increase? Same house, they haven't built out, they haven't added anything to it. And you have to feel for those homeowners, and frankly, feel for all the rest of us who are also property taxpayers, when you see those kinds of increases. If we cap taxes at 2%, if nothing else, it instills some fiscal discipline. It forces our local communities to deal with the realities of perhaps looking at things a little differently. And not saying that they don't right now, but perhaps it gives them an added measure, and certainly I think reassures our taxpayers that there will be some fiscal responsibility across the board as they move forward.
Tell us more about the day of you and your colleagues on Long Island. Did you get much support?
Oh, absolutely. You know, this is an issue that is clearly one that people recognize as being needed right now. We passed it right away in the Senate. The governor proposed it. We passed it. We embraced it. Certainly, it makes a lot of sense. Our constituents understand how important it is. You know, it's a little strange to me. The Speaker of the Assembly took the governor's program bill. He is the sponsor.
Right.
He controls those matters that are debated and that reach a floor vote. Yet he continues to say he's in favor of tax cap, but he won't move that piece of legislation forward. And essentially has held it ransom, for whatever reason, these last 4 months, has not allowed it to at least progress to a debate or a discussion. And if there's one thing that I've seen in my discussions with members of the Assembly on both sides of the aisle, is that there's overwhelming support in that chamber for a tax cap. So hopefully the Speaker will allow it to come to a vote. The governor, obviously it's his program bill, will sign it. And we can send a real signal to New York State taxpayers that it's a new age, and certainly we're acting responsibly as well.
Right. A Long Island homeowner that was with you that day, she talked about how you're always hearing about the senior citizen or the young person not being able to live in New York and being forced out. But she said, you know, what about the regular wage earners? What about people in their 40s and 50s like herself? You know, she and her husband also have difficulties. Let's go out and listen to a portion of what she had to say.
Absolutely.
When it comes to taxes, I am reminded of a great lesson from the Bible. Render to Caesar what belongs to Caesar and give to God what belongs to God. A high-functioning society cannot exist without some form of tax collection. We don't mind paying our fair share of taxes, except when the taxation becomes unjust and out of control. New Yorkers need tax relief. My family needs this tax cap on our property taxes. Thank you.
So this cap, as you mentioned, won't solve every problem, but it serves as a foundation.
That's really what it does. And you know, if you think about that example, that was Mrs. Curley, that was her example.
Right.
You know, $6,000 8 years ago in property taxes, over $11,000 today. That family is struggling. They have children. They're saving for their own futures and for their children's futures. Taxes cannot go up that significantly and not have a detrimental effect. And then you consider, I mean, that was 8 years ago, you consider that we've gone through a recession and we're still, in many people's minds, in the middle of a recession. People just don't have the flexibility to continue to spend that much. Mm-hmm. And as much as they have shown fiscal restraint in their own lives, I don't think it's too much to ask for them to expect that the government is going to show the same level of fiscal restraint in their lives as well.
Right. So do you expect this to pass this session?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think people want it. I think eventually the Assembly is going to have to come on board. I'm looking forward to seeing whatever they propose. I know that it may not necessarily be in the same form that we passed. I'm committed to that which we passed, but I'm certainly waiting to see what they do on their end.
Right. Tell us about the mock trial that you were asked to preside over.
It was a lot of fun. I mean, anytime you have an opportunity to meet with, in this case, fifth graders who participated in a mock trial, there's one of the witnesses right there. It's really pretty neat. They were excellent. They discussed a very difficult piece of law having to do with discrimination, people with disabilities. They were very impressive. Not only they took both sides. There was a defense and there was a plaintiff. There were witnesses that were lined up. They came in. They testified. They put exhibits in, and ultimately, I think both sides won. The case was decided in I think the way that it should have been decided, and then it was a tough decision to give on points. Which team came out ahead? But I got to tell you, school districts that take the opportunity to allow children to get outside of the classroom and get out of the basic curriculum and encourage them to think outside the box. These kids were taught to or encouraged to think outside the box. They had to prepare their case. They had to prepare their questions. They had to keep those questions in proper form. And they were great. I mean, they were really, for fifth graders, they're as good as many attorneys that I've seen in a courtroom. It really is pretty neat. And the fact that the Manor Haven School did that, the Port Washington School District encourages it, is a real testament to that entire school district.
Absolutely. It makes learning exciting.
Well, it really does. And again, it teaches them not just to memorize, but it teaches them to think, mm-hmm. which is really what we want to do.
Yeah. Did any of them come up to you to talk individually about the case?
Oh, absolutely. Afterwards. And that's a great point. Afterwards, they all came up. And they were asking about different points and how I observed or what my thoughts were with respect to certain aspects of the case. So it wasn't just that they went through the exercise. They actually were invested and came in and followed through. So it was pretty neat.
You gave a keynote speech at this year's Armed Forces Day celebration in South Laurel Park. So tell us the significance of this day.
Well, it was a great opportunity. I really was honored to be asked to participate. South Laurel Park holds Armed Forces Day, which is the third weekend in May every year. They've held it now for 22 years. And it's just an opportunity to recognize our armed forces throughout the world, our active armed forces. Memorial Day is next week, where we recognize all of the veterans who have passed, and many of whom gave the ultimate sacrifice and all of whom sacrificed for our country. And then we have Veterans Day in November, where we recognize our veterans. Armed Forces Day is where we recognize our current armed forces. And I think it's just a critical component. And certainly when we do have so many of our friends and neighbors and family members fighting all over the world and certainly in harm's way, half a world away, we should keep them in mind. And it's just one more reminder that we hope they arrive home safely, we hope that they stay safe, and we still have a commitment. I mean, we go about our daily lives not realizing that we do have friends and family in harm's way, half a world away. And it's important every day for us to remember that.
Absolutely. It's a tough life to live.
No question about it. For them, for their families, we take it for granted that things are okay because it doesn't immediately impact us. But we should also recognize and appreciate the fact that there are people out there sacrificing on our behalf.
All right. You are also the guest speaker at a breakfast meeting of the Great Neck Chamber of Commerce. So tell us what you talked about.
Well, the Great Neck Chamber is a special place. Great Neck is a great community. Their chamber is probably one of the more active ones, certainly on Long Island. They've got a thriving downtown community. They've got various downtowns, but certainly very proactive. I had an opportunity to meet with them. We discussed local issues. We discussed the governor's initiative for redevelopment, their councils, and how we broke the state down into regions, and how we're looking forward to working with the governor and the lieutenant governor as we determine how best to address the needs of Long Island. This is a very proactive group, members of the local business community, members of the local various villages and boards who are represented here in this photo. Great group, and certainly people who understand how important it is that they're part of a community, not only as political leaders, but as business leaders, that it does take the different aspects of a community to make a community great, and great next to great community.
I understand there were hundreds of community members that packed the Elmont Memorial High School International Night. Tell us, this is to celebrate different cultures?
Celebrate different cultures. What a great, great night. Anytime you put high school kids together and you see that kind of synergy, it didn't matter what your background was. They had Caribbean culture and representatives from Haiti and representatives from South Asia, India, representatives from Mexico and from literally all over the world. And the fact that they brought them together and the kind of support that you saw from and encouragement that you saw from different elements in the community and the kids, there was no us and them when it comes to the Elmont community. They truly work together. I truly enjoy going there, seeing that, being part of that. I'm just fortunate that they've included me as part of their their celebrations and their organization. Every time I'm invited, I'll be back in Elmont. It really is a special place.
So the families prepare different types of foods. There was a fashion show and dance team.
There was a fashion show and dance team. And by the way, Elmont High School has a competition on Varsity MSG down there. So for anyone who's paying attention, make sure to vote for Elmont dance team. They've made it, I guess, to the next level, and we want to make sure they continue to. It's important. That's an aside. Their international night was fantastic. Again, food, culture, but no matter where they came from, whatever their backgrounds were, to see them supporting each other was really special.
A great learning experience.
Absolutely.
So you have what you call community listening tours around your district, where instead of waiting for constituents to come to you, you make yourself available to them. So this past Friday, you were at Floral Park Library. How was the turnout?
Great turnout. For Friday afternoon in Floral Park, this is where things happen. Being able to meet with the community, get input from the community directly, look someone in the eye, answer a question, and not wait for them to call your office, send you an email, send you a letter. Mm-hmm. Go right into the community and let's address those issues. And we talked about tax caps. We talked about the budget. We talked about the priorities that the state makes when it comes to different types of cuts. We talked about education and Medicaid. We talked about the issues. We talked about the issues that are important to each and every one of us individually, and we're dealing with them, but this allows us to put a human face on it. And that's what it's all about. It's not about coming up to Albany and passing legislation. It's about going home and understanding what the people need, and that the only way you're going to do that is through forums like that. Mm-hmm. So we were in Floral Park that time. We've been in Manhasset. We've been in other areas of the district where it is important to have them come up. And sometimes the questions can be uncomfortable, because there are people who have been directly impacted by decisions that the state has made. But we should be able to take not only the good questions, but also the more difficult questions, and have that kind of a discussion.
Yeah, that's what you're here for.
That's why we're here.
Thank you so much for being with us, Senator.
My pleasure. Thank you.
For any additional information, you can log on to the Senator's website, martins.nysenate.gov.